Are we ready? Okay, I think we're ready to start. The planning board meeting will come to order, please. I'd like to welcome all of you in our audience and all of you who are watching us on TV. This is the regular meeting, the July meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First on the agenda, do I hear a motion to waive a reading of the minutes of our June meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes of the June meeting?
Madam Chairman,
yes.
First I'd like to compliment the Secretary on the very complete minutes that we received. I thought it was very
excellent.
Helpful. There are a few corrections. On page one, a letter, May 15th, under correspondence, a letter from, is that Cog, perhaps?
It probably is Cog.
And on the next page, another piece of correspondence, May 25th, probably Cog again.
Yes, Cog.
And down at the bottom of that very same page, the sentence reads, Mr. Drinan stated that at one time a former owner, Hugo Sondergaard, trucked many dump loads of fill over a period of time into the wetlands. I wonder if that might be changed to read aloud many truckloads to be.
Sounds all right to me. You're a good proofreader, Mrs. Rand.
There is one more correction I have on the fourth page. The fourth paragraph down, Mr. Most and I seem to be connected, and that should read Ivan Most rather than Ivan Rand.
Okay, very good. And I have an additional correction. On page three, I think it's about the fifth paragraph. It said, Mrs. Guthrie told Mrs. Alexander her letter had been sent on to the town council as sewers are not the purview of the planning board. That's fine. But to go on, I would like to amend what follows. I said there is a strict sewer code, and the sewer ordinance does not make exceptions for sensitive parcels of land. Should the sewer ordinance be changed before the development of these lots, then a condition of approval concerning this subdivision should state that all lots be connected to the sewer. Any other additions or corrections on the June minutes? If not, do I hear a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
I would so move.
Thank you, Mrs. Rand. Is there a second? Is there a second? Okay, thank you. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion is carried. Next correspondence, you will not be treated to such a lengthy list this month. We had very little correspondence. On July 11th, a letter dated July 11th from William D. Alexander IV of Mitchell Road, asking that the developer be required to sewer all eligible lots at Meadowview. On July 12th, Daniel Boxer, an excellent letter concerning the potential subdivision at Broad Cove. We will address Dan Boxer's letter should and if this subdivision, should it move forward. And lastly, a memo from COG concerning a meeting about affordable housing, which I am attending this coming Thursday at 7 p.m. at Westbrook College. That's July 20th. If anyone is interested, please speak with me after the meeting. It sounds like a wonderful meeting. Our first order of business, I think that we have representatives here from the Maine Cellular Telephone Company. We wish to apologize profusely to you for forgetting part of our work at the last meeting. We've really been very understanding about it. Is there any discussion on the proposed motion before us, what we forgot last time? There are really two motions before us. The first is essentially a finding of fact. Any discussion, or Steve, would you care to fill in the planning board about any of this?
I think the board was pretty much ready to grant this planning board permit last meeting. Just happened in the excitement and rush of giving the site plan approval, it was passed aside. I think that usually a planning board permit for construction and resource protection district is a serious matter which is looked at carefully by the planning board. And what I think it has been in this case, but given the fact that the construction would occur in a mapped wetland or resource protection zone, which in fact really doesn't have any characteristics that one would normally find in such a district, I think the planning board, at least at the last meeting, probably would have voted very easily to grant it. So I think in this case, unless there's some issues that have come up and haven't been raised beforehand, that the motion before you pretty much follows along with what you would have decided at the last meeting.
Thank you, Steve. Any discussion or questions?
I would like to make a motion.
Thank you.
Be it ordered that the planning board finds that Maine Cellular's proposal to locate 180 feet tall telecommunication tower within a mapped resource protection district meets the applicable criteria contained in section 19-2-8C of the zoning ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of the Maine Cellular for a planning board permit to locate an 180 feet tower telecommunication tower within a mapped resource protection district located off Spurwink Avenue be granted according to section 19-2-8 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Thank you. A second from Mr. Tinsman. Any discussion? None. So all in favor? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries unanimously. Well, congratulations once again. And as you said in the beginning, it ain't over till it's over. Thank you very much, and we apologize again. Before we get to the next two items on the agenda, which include Meadowview and Spurwink Woods, I'd like to bring up something about conflicts of interest, which seem to have emerged as one of the burning issues of the 1980s. And conflicts of interest, I guess, have to do with pecuniary interest and sometimes bias. And I would just like to bring out to everyone on the planning board that Meadowview and Spurwink Woods are two issues on which I could be biased because of my previous friendship and current friendship with not only Mr. Drinan, but the entire Drinan family. I have known the Drinans, I think, for approximately 13 years since you came from Pakistan, and they've been neighbors to me twice, and I could essentially be biased concerning not only Mr. Drinan's Spurwink Woods, I guess it's called, development. And now it seems that a legal issue could be arising on the Meadowview project, and I just think it would be in the best interests of the town, the planning board, Mr. Drynan, if I did not vote on these two issues. So according to our new rules, I think that the whole planning board now has to vote on whether a member is indeed biased. So you're allowed to discuss this, and I guess I would turn the chair over to Ivan to lead this discussion, and you will have to vote on whether you think that I am biased. And if you don't think I'm biased, there is a matter of the appearance of bias involved in this. So if you will direct your questions to Ivan, we can both sit where we are. We've never done this before.
Before you leave, Marion,
yes.
I've looked at those rules, and I don't think, and as long as we get Tom here, maybe we can take advantage of him, it would be straining what is normally done to have us vote on whether or not you can sit on an application. What happens if we vote that you have to?
Does that mean that you have to?
And at least I was always under the impression that that slavery had been outlawed, which leads me to conclude that the only reasonable interpretation of those rules is that if a member is challenged or a question is raised as to the ability of that member of the planning board to participate in the discussion, and the member of the planning board says, I don't think I have a conflict, then it's not up to that person to decide, but it's up to the board to decide. I think every time we abstain or recuse ourselves, if we go through the drill of having us all decide whether we're entitled to do that, I think we're straining those rules and probably going beyond what was intended. And the bottom line of all this is, I think, I disagree with your conclusion, because we all have friends who appear all the time before us, and it's a small town. But if you want to abstain, I think it's your choice. And I think the vote only comes and the discussion only comes if you don't want to, after disclosing or being challenged, and we have to decide it. I'd be interested in Tom's view, because maybe we can set a press on how we're going to do it.
Because these are brand new planning board rules, and this is the first time they've gone into effect, Tom, so we would appreciate your input.
I'm just going to ratify and agree with what Dan said. In my opinion, the voting comes in if there's a challenge by the applicant, party objecting, or a member of the public. Prior to that, if any planning board member feels that, whether it's the one side of pecuniary or personal interest, or on the other side, they just know the person or have a view of the matter that they cannot, not that they know the person, but that they cannot fulfill their sworn duties to apply the criteria and vote on a matter presented to you. If you feel so biased that you can't do that objectively, you should step aside. And really, what the other members think, you know, they really can't get in your head and figure that out. It's really what motivates you and how strongly you feel about something. I do agree that's really when it's challenged, and perhaps somebody says, well, you're biased, and you say, well, no, I'm not. And then you really have to look to your fellow members and say, I don't think I am. This is my view. And if it doesn't rise to the level of being a true conflict, then you can, if they so vote, then you stay on. If they say you ought to pass, then so be it. So I agree with what Dan said, and I think when it arises from you, you know best,
right,
as to either your interest or your bias, and if it's so strong that you feel compelled, then you should do it, and no one should overrule it one way or the other.
Okay, thank you.
Tom, I've got a question for you while you're there. Alice just whispered in my ear, and I was thinking of exactly the same thing. If indeed these new rules are ambiguous, and I agree with Dan totally, I really think it's a self decision. I mean, if you feel uncomfortable in voting on something, you should make the group aware of it and step aside. I mean, I don't see how you could be forced to act on something that you feel uncomfortable about. I agree that the vote should come in the case of a challenge, and I'm just curious, why aren't our rules written that way?
I don't know. I didn't draft them. I'd be glad to look at them and review them. I've seen them before in this town, both council rules and other rules for this town and other towns have that. I've simply interpreted that way. This is not a new view on my part. I've shared it with different people, perhaps here or with other boards in this town. That's been my view, is that it's really a challenge rule.
Sure.
It just doesn't say that, but that's how I've interpreted it.
In a workshop on these rules, Town Council Ordinance Committee was rather insistent that we include this in our general operating rules.
Well, I think they're... let me tell you where I think it can hurt, and that is if someone's kind of on the fence, it may be easier to recuse yourself and abstain and say, well, you know, it's not worth it. It's me, to the board, to the town. I don't want to get in trouble, period. I'm going to get off. Well, that's not fair to the rest of the board in a lot of cases, and it's not fair to an applicant if a person's abstention, who may have a lot to contribute and is a full voting member of the board, is given up or was made too quickly. The abstention is made too quickly. So that's where, you know, I think the thought of the other view of the voting comes from, which is, you know, if it was something that was so minor but you wanted to clear it, then you can clear it and everybody can say it's okay, you know. Particularly if it... I can see situations and have seen situations where if too many people do that, you know, there's no quorum, the person can never get the vote to get an application through, and that's happened to boards throughout the state. And so it's, I think maybe partly with that in mind that the voting is there. Personally, I think if somebody has a disabling conflict by pecuniary interest or bias, they have to abstain. And whether we have a voting rule or not, that decision is tainted and subject to be voided in a court action if a person with that bias or conflict votes. So I think it's a matter of kind of a way of resolving things. If there's a dispute, challenge, what have you, that's the way I look at it, primarily that. I wasn't at that committee hearing, but that's right. That's my feeling.
I read that language, Alice, as carrying with it the implication that the vote only comes if there's a contested decision, meaning, you know, there's a question about the decision. So you can, if you read them with some, I think, some rationality injected into them, it makes sense. I think it's only if you read them sort of in the abstract that you could say, gee, we have to have a vote on every conflict. I think I'm saying the same thing, but I think you can, you don't have to say we're acting contrary to the rules that the council insisted. I think you can read those rules as allowing an individual to step aside and only requiring a vote when there's an issue to be voted on. There's no issue if you say, I'm not going to vote. You could have stayed home tonight.
Could I ask another question then? How far do individual members have to go in disclosing if nobody's challenged, or if a member of the public or the member on the board has challenged a person?
Well, I think you only have to disclose when you've reached your own personal decision that it rises to the level of a disability. You know, the pecuniary interest is clear, more clear cut. If somebody has a financial interest, or there are people here who work in firms, law firms, businesses, what have you, that may be involved with an applicant or a partner, maybe. Some of those are clear. We've been over those many times with the council, and if there's a pecuniary interest, they could be seen between the applicant or the objecting party and the board. I think those are the easiest ones, okay? The bias, you know, I like to think of it that the planning board members weren't chosen because they came here without any opinions. They were chosen because they have opinions, they have a mind, and they have views of things, and they bring all that to bear when they decide things. So a bias really has to rise to a certain level, I think, to disqualify somebody. And I think if you're uncomfortable and you feel that, gee, you know, I think whatever this guy says, I'm going to believe him because, you know, I know he wouldn't lie because I, you know, and I don't trust this guy because, you know, if you have a real strong feeling about the individuals and can't act objectively, or the project, if it's just a project that the ordinances allow but you personally don't think is right, and because it's a loophole or something, I mean, those are the sort of things that I see can be so strong that you could be disabled. But you're going to have opinions, you're going to know people, it's a small town. You know, it really has to be enough that you really feel that you cannot act objectively. And if you feel you can act objectively, you know, then I don't think this is, you know, kind of like a confessional where everybody says, well, I know so-and-so, and, you know, I might, I think it's just the way it goes, unless you feel that there's a risk to taint and void the decision and that you are, in fact, biased or unobjective.
So in this particular circumstance, since Marion has disclosed her what she perceives as a possible bias, then we would not, it's your opinion that we would not have to take a vote on this. She can just make her judgment.
It is.
If someone challenges her.
If I could start over.
How you read that?
Yeah, if I could start over, though, I'm not sure that the Madam Chairman understood all that, so I'd like her to rethink that, perhaps, as Dan said, that, you know, I'm not sure if she was looking for a vote because that's the formality, or she was looking for a vote because she wanted to hear if other people agreed with her. So,
no, I was looking for a vote because Steve and I had discussed this, and our interpretation of the rules included voting every single time this issue came up, and that's I'm delighted that you came forward because it's a very uncomfortable situation to.
Yeah. Well, with that advice, I think, again, it would be up to you at this juncture if you
feel. So this is a test case.
I'm glad. Aren't you glad you came?
So I think, again, up to you to.
To decide.
To decide, and you know.
Thank you.
Again,
Thank you. Any other questions from Tom? Well, I think I have to decide immediately, and I think I could be objective. However, I worry because I have such a great affection for this entire family that the appearance of bias could emerge. And if legal issues arise, I would be very uncomfortable searching my soul to decide whether I were biased. I was biased. I do know a lot of people who come forward here in Cape Elizabeth, but I have eaten many fine meals at the Drynan's home. They, in turn, have eaten many poor meals at mine since I am such a poor cook. So it goes beyond just being acquaintances. I have watched their daughters grow. So I think that it would be in the best interests of the town and Mr. Drynan if I turned the gavel over to Ivan Most and impose on you, Ivan.
Okay.
And I'll be back when these two issues have.
Just for clarification, Marion, it would be the Meadowview six-lot subdivision and Spurwink Woods both.
That is correct, and you will have to appoint an associate.
Yes, I will.
Member to vote. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if we could comment as members of the board as well, since this is the first time that we've taken the potential for conflict this far. With your permission, I will do so.
Sure.
All right. I think everyone has very nicely indicated their own feelings and the readings of the rules and the background, and I don't disagree in any way with Marion's decision to excuse herself from discussion of voting on these two issues. Going back to something Tom Leahy had indicated, though, I think it puts potentially future boards into a very difficult situation, maybe, if this board when an applicant comes before it and all of the board members or the majority of board members know the applicant and may be very friendly with the applicant, of not being able to participate in a discussion, therefore shutting down a potential project that may be in the best interest of the town because we know and may be very close to individuals. So I think that the records should show, and maybe some of us will be around someday when it comes up again, that is a personal decision. It's an appropriate personal decision that one member makes given the facts of a particular circumstance. I would hope that this board and future boards in other towns don't feel so highly constrained that when an applicant comes in that they have to excuse themselves where they know them and are friendly with them. And I would hope that this isn't a precedent to future actions where applicants who may, or someone that may be opposed to an application comes before this board and says you have precedent here where you one of your members knew and was very friendly with an applicant had to excuse themselves from voting, because I think that could be very tough for us to deal with. So I guess what I really wanted to say is that it's a personal decision that one planning board member has made appropriately, and that it's for each member to decide at some point where they feel that they would be biased in favor or biased against a particular application because of knowledge of those people and background with the applicant.
So, if Mr. Tinsman, if I can summarize what you're saying, are you saying basically that this decision of Marion's is not precedent for any future decisions? Those decisions have to be an individual planning board's decision, member's decision at that time.
I would hope that would be the case, and that's what I've heard Tom Leahy, our corporation counsel, say this evening.
Fine. Thank you for that clarification. Before we go further, in order of appointment to the board, I'd like to appoint Judy Wyman as a voting member in Marion's absence on these next two issues. I have received a letter from town council, Tom Leahy, concerning the next item on our agenda. And prior to going into that item, I've asked Tom to be here because of potential difficulties with an issue of this subdivision that I thought that the planning board would like to have the benefit of Tom's counsel on. And since I feel it's probably beneficial to go into executive session at this time on this issue, I'm not sure what the rules are on this, but I believe I need to move. Somebody has to move that, and I think I have to announce the exact items we are going to discuss in executive session, if I remember the correct procedures on that. The issue at heart here is the issue of modification of a wetlands in the past and how it might affect an application currently. I believe that's the issue that we want to discuss. It would be my preference to go into executive session. I'd like to know what the feelings of the board are, and do I have a move? Can somebody move that action?
I would make that motion that we do go into executive session on that topic, and that we also make a clear announcement to the public that there will be no decisions made at
correct.
That time.
We will be discussing that topic and that topic only, and there will be no decisions made. Is it seconded? Any discussion?
How long do you expect it will be in executive session?
I expect we'll be in executive session not to exceed 15 minutes. Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We probably should go into executive session outside the room, I would guess. I think there's some room upstairs. Downstairs? Okay. Yes, please. Section 16-2-4 of our ordinances. Would the applicant care to come to the podium and announce? Would you please give us your name and affiliation?
Okay. My name is Lisa Cowan. I'm the landscape architect with Mitchell & Associates. We've been before the board before. We've been retained to prepare this preliminary application for KW Associates of South Portland.
Could you move a little bit forward? I'm not sure the mic is live.
Is it coming?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
We've already been before the board on a few occasions, and the last occasion was a public hearing. And at that public hearing, specific concerns were raised about the subdivision, which is located on Mitchell Road, and the name of it is Meadowview. Specific concerns were raised by neighbors and planning board members, and what we'd like to do tonight is address those specific concerns so that the board can consider preliminary subdivision approval. As you may recall, I'm going to be presenting some of the concerns and proposals that we're making with regards to buffering, open space, and the wetland fill issue. And then later, Mark Ray, a professional engineer with BH2M of Gorham, will be presenting a little bit on septic systems and any flooding concerns that have been raised. With regards to buffering, at the public hearing, some neighbors expressed their desire to have the subdivision screened from their properties. And what we have presented here tonight, the plan that we're presenting tonight, and the ones that you received in your packets, shows a little bit more of an accurate depiction of the mixed evergreen and deciduous border that right now lines both property lines, and we're trying to depict that a little more accurately. And we made notes on the plan to clarify where a dense wood may begin and end and where some trees exist. And what we have done is reinforced or added additional evergreens to the areas of concern, namely on the northern side of on the Drynan border and down on the southern side of the Alexander border. And we've added, about 10 trees, 10 evergreens, and in addition, we raised the size of those trees from, they were 5 to 6 feet at the time of planting. Now we're going to be planting in those areas 6 to 8 foot trees. Also, since the public hearing, Ken and Wayne, partners at KW, met with the Conservation Commission to get their recommendations about open space concerns at the Cape. And I want to say that meeting was very fruitful because it gave us a better understanding of their goals and what they're trying to achieve. After that meeting, Ken and Wayne went back and they came up with a solution, and Ken was able to present it to Mrs. Tinsman, the chairman of the Conservation Commission. And what that solution is to establish a pedestrian easement 25 feet wide from the back of lot number three right here, from the back of that lot, which is linking up to an existing pedestrian easement, and bringing it along so it can eventually hook up with a pedestrian easement south of the Hopstone, I don't know if they're condominiums or development. So basically, what this will do is further the goals of the commission of providing a green belt in this area. And so they are willing to do this, and it's our understanding that Mrs. Tinsman said that she was in agreement with the solution. Finally, before I turn the mic over to Mark, I'd like to briefly address the wetland fill issue. During the initial design phases of this project and our discussions with the clients, we determined and everybody agreed to make every effort to avoid utilizing or affecting the fill as part of the development. Even before the letter was written to the board or whatever, we established a wetland buffer of 20 feet off of the wetland, and we included the entire area of the fill in that buffer area. And that buffer area is saying no clearing, no building inside that line. So the entire fill area is being contained within that buffer line, and therefore we feel that we have made extra effort to separate the two, because we thought if it did come up, we did not want to have it be an issue related to our development. And we'd like
Could I just ask a question, just as a point of clarification, that in the area that is filled, which was in the wetland fill area, there will be no construction, no roads?
No roads, no construction, no clearing.
Okay.
Nothing.
All right.
And then we would like the board to consider that as part of the fact that we have made this sort of effort and that you can separate the two issues and consider them so you don't need to possibly hold up a preliminary subdivision approval. So I'm going to turn over the mic now to Mark, and he'll be discussing two other concerns that came up at the meeting.
My name again is Mark Gray, and I'm with BH2M Engineers. I'm a professional engineer, and I was retained by Mitchell & Associates to address the stormwater management portion of the project. Just quickly going over what I know you've all heard before, but I'll go over it again. What I'll talk about is how the site handled its drainage prior to development, how we anticipate it will handle the drainage after the development, talk about the impact of the stormwater runoff from the site on the stream and adjacent properties. And then I will talk about, in a limited way, the septic systems that are planned for the site. First, this is a plan of how the stormwater will run off, or how it currently runs off, I should say. There's an area here adjacent to Mitchell Road above the project, northerly of the project, that currently sheds a stormwater runoff along the gutter line of Mitchell Road, where it scoots back onto the property and sheets across to the south, ultimately down into the wetland. The eastern portion of the site, which is the developed portion of the site, we broke up into two different areas. This area here, which we call pre-2, is essentially all drains to the south across the stone wall or along the stone wall onto the abutting property to the south. This sub-area here, which we call pre-1, has drains overland into the wetland area. After development, of course, there's a roadway with a cul-de-sac about 500 feet long. This area will intercept the roadway, I should say, will intercept all the runoff, stormwater runoff, from this area of the site in catch basins and discharge it directly into the wetlands. Okay, this is accomplished by providing a curb along Mitchell Road here to keep the runoff that is in the gutter above the property in the gutter rather than allowing it to sheet, and picking it up in a catch basin here, where it's closed piped. Anything coming overland here or on the road comes into the catch basins and is discharged directly into the wetland area. This area here, which I've designated post 2, as before development, will continue to sheet southerly onto the abutting property. Post 3, which is analogous again to pre-1, essentially does the same thing that it did, and that's to sheet into the wetland area. Now, in terms of impact, what this is a stormwater hydrograph. It models, or it represents, the flow in the brook, at the point the brook leaves the property. The purpose in creating this graph here is to demonstrate the effect of the additional runoff coming from the site as a result of the development. The impact is here. I guess what I should do is back up and explain to you what a hydrograph is. A hydrograph is nothing more than a representation of the amount of flow in the brook as a function of time. In other words, if you look right here, 11 hours into the storm, there's very little flow. 13 hours into the storm, the stream peaks, has its maximum flow of over 250 CFS. And then as time goes on, in the 17th hour and the 22nd hour, the stream recedes again. What has happened as a result of the development is that all of the stormwater runoff from the site runs off prior to the peak level occurring in the stream. Therefore, the statement can be made that there will be no increase in peak runoff from the site. And on that basis, we've recommended no stormwater detention. The other conclusion that can be drawn from this is that there is no increase in flooding because there is no increase in the peak run or the peak amount of volume that runs through the stream. If the amount of water running through the stream is the same, then hydraulically the stream and the wetland will operate as it did before.
Excuse me, can I interrupt to ask a question? Is this based on a 24-hour storm?
Yes. Mm-hmm. The model that we used was TR-55 tabular model. And
a 25-year?
We looked at both the 2-year mm-hmm. design storm and the 25-year frequency design mm-hmm. storm, which is what you see here is the hydrograph for the 25-year storm, which dumps 5.4 inches of rain in 24 hours. Okay. In terms of impact.
Just for information, but that doesn't make any conclusions about the time of the year, the condition of the ground, whether it's froze or not, right? That calculation just does not include that, does it?
Yes, it does. It presupposes an antecedent moisture condition that's average.
It's average. Okay.
Excuse me?
Yes.
The echoes, it must be.
Yeah.
When you speak of the brook, you mean the brook at the wetlands way in the back where everything eventually ends up. Is that right?
Yes. I think...
After the sheeting, after the back...
Well, the brook actually starts over across the road, the adjacent road, the name of which escapes me, the next one over. Mitchell Road is here. Across, I think there's a golf course over there, if memory serves. It starts there, comes across the road, meanders through the property, the western part of the property, comes back down and exits in that direction. Okay? In this area, it lacks a lot of stream or defined channel. Mm-hmm. Kind of there is a channel that runs through there, but in a large storm event, it would kind of spread out over the entire wetland area. Does that answer your question?
I'm just trying to visualize where the water is going. Now, when the catch basins are in,
right,
it's going to drain it directly into the stream?
That's right. It will dump it into this wetland area where it will diffuse and ultimately
into
the stream.
Okay, which is running straight into the stream there?
No, it doesn't come all the way into the stream because we would disturb the wetland in order to extend the outlet.
No, I understand. I'm visualizing which way the water flows. It flows one way that way and that
That's
way
right.
the other way.
This area generally flows in that direction. Mm-hmm. This area flows in this direction normally, but before development. Mm-hmm. After development, this area continues to flow in this direction, but is intercepted by the road and its catch basin system and is discharged directly into the wetland at a much quicker mm-hmm. rate.
But the peak won't go up.
The peak won't go up.
It's losing me somewhere.
Okay, well, let me go back to the hydrograph. The reason that the peak doesn't go up is because even though there's more water,
uh-huh.
the area under this curve represents the total amount of water in the storm that's going to run down the stream. We are adding more water because there's more impervious surface, the land mm-hmm. cover changes, mm-hmm. so on and so forth. We're shooting it out quicker. But that quantity of water happens initially, very quickly. All that stormwater is already down the brook and headed for the ocean before the stream peaks. So the impact on the stream is that there's no increase in flooding.
It's not going to have this big flash flood 45 minutes after it starts to rain?
No. And as a matter of fact, this development has an almost minuscule effect on the entire watershed. The upstream watershed is very large in comparison to this development. Matter of fact, that's exaggerated. in order to show you something, we made it fat. It's probably five or six times as big as it really is.
Okay, I have to think about this. This has gone beyond my... Okay.
Under what kind of circumstances would you have an increase?
A lot of times the position of the development in the watershed has a large impact on whether detention is required or not. If your development is right at the top of the watershed, then what will happen is you are going to be contributing directly to, in other words, you don't have an opportunity to get your stormwater down the stream in a way. It's just going to become part of this large mass. In that kind of a case, where you're at the top end of the watershed or at the headwaters, if you will, stormwater detention can be just about the only solution to keep the post-development peak flow to pre-development levels.
You're basically saying here that the post-development flow is going to join the stream when it's a drop in the bucket.
That's right.
Mark, are you also saying that there are some cases, not necessarily this one because of the contribution, but some cases where detention, if it aligned itself with the peak, could be bad?
That's right. That's right. In this particular case, and I mentioned that in the report, in this particular case, if you were to detain these flows and meter them out and they happen to coincide with the peak, it still wouldn't have a large impact. It would still only... you know, bump it up somewhat, but you could actually increase the peak by detaining it. It's far from a simple subject matter, unfortunately, and it varies with each site.
It's interesting, though, it does point out the importance of wetlands and their capacitance effect.
Yes.
Quite a bit. Yeah.
Okay. In terms of impacts on adjacent properties, the property to the south here formerly received the stormwater runoff from this entire area. Because of the introduction of this road and the interception of the stormwater runoff from this area and its discharge directly into the wetland and hence into the stream, the net effect of the development is to reduce the amount of overland flow onto the southerly abutter by at least 50%. So there is a positive impact on the upstream portion of the southerly abutter's land. There is more water going on into the wetlands area, as it was demonstrated on the hydrograph. There's actually more water, but it will not impact the flooding situation because the flood is caused by the peak flow in the brook. And because the flow from the development will be gone before the peak flow occurs, there will be no flooding. So the flooding that's currently experienced in the wetlands area of the abutting property will not be increased. And by the same token, the flooding that is experienced in the low-lying areas of the abutting property to the north will also not be increased. There is no increase because there's no increase in total discharge. And we're not altering the hydraulic characteristics of the stream. Then you can make the conclusion that there is no more flooding, no additional flooding.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the board? No. Were you going to also address the septic systems?
I was going to discuss them briefly, yes. As has been mentioned before, there are six lots here, two of which are planned to be sewered, connected to the town sewer. These four lots, lots 2, 3, 4, and 5, are going to be handled with subsurface disposal systems. There has been a letter written to the board by Mr. Albert Frick, who was the designer. Who is the designer of the subsurface disposal systems. And briefly, to summarize that letter, and to respond to some of the issues that have been raised. Mr. Frick states that all these systems have been designed according to the State of Maine subsurface disposal rules. He presents statistics that indicate that, among other statistics, that approximately 5% of these systems fail in the first 10 years, which is a fairly good reliability rate. These are chambered systems, and they are a preferred method in cases like this because they take up less room. They take about half as much room as a more conventional piped bed. Something that some more points that we want to make beyond what are stated in Mr. Frick's letter is the, if you'll allow me, and pardon me if I tell you something you already know, but I thought I'd just quickly go through how a septic system operates.
Just for a point of fact, this was received obviously too late to be in our packets for this month, so we really cannot consider this letter as part of our deliberations tonight, but so your explanation will have to suffice.
All right, fine. A septic system or a subsurface disposal system takes waste, black water waste, which is the waste from the toilet, and gray water waste, which is waste from the washing machines, sinks, showers, those kinds of things, and pipes it into a septic tank, which typically is a precast concrete structure about 4 feet deep and 4 feet wide and about 8 feet long, which is buried under the ground with sufficient cover to keep the frost away. The water and the waste that enters this tank is settled out and separated. What that does is it settles any solids that don't float to the bottom of the tank, where they're treated anaerobically, in other words, by bacteria that don't like oxygen. Anything that floats, such as grease, scum, any other objects that won't settle, are trapped by the baffles in the tank, because the tank maintains a constant liquid level. The intent here is to keep solids from discharging through the pipe and to provide treatment. The effluent from this septic tank then goes into the disposal field, which can either be a chamber type or a bed type, where it percolates down through a bed of crushed stone and gravel into the subsoil. This chamber or the field actually provides further treatment for the septic effluent. And the effluent ultimately becomes part of the groundwater table and disperses and is diluted. This is a very common and very accepted way of handling individual residents' sanitary waste. The other thing that you might want to note about a septic system is that if it fails, it's pretty obvious. There's a anaerobic bacteria are very smelly. They just it's just an obnoxious odor. I'm sure you've all smelled them before. It's fairly easy to fix them, too. You have to dig up the bed and clean out the piping if it's clogged, because the septic system, if the septic tank isn't pumped periodically, a lot of times those bad solids can make it out and impact the field. But it's before things get out of hand, the situation can be remedied, and it's a very sound, I guess the conclusion we'd like you to reach is that it's a sound, acceptable way of handling the discharge. It also isn't going to have any more impact than any farm application would have on the land.
I have a question on your septic system itself. On lot number 5, which seems to be the most detrimental lot for a septic system, Mr. Frick's design sets the chamber system above the septic tank itself. That it requires some pumping. What happened, the chamber system itself, does that work on evaporation, or is that a leaching system that leaches down into the soil?
It leaches down into the soil.
So in essence, the septic diagram that you have there is actually the chamber itself sits, in this instance, I think, if I can read the slopes right, 4, 5, 6 feet above the house itself.
It's if you're in a situation, and I haven't seen the design, so pardon me, but my own house, the leach field is probably 15 feet higher than the septic tank, and the effluent from this septic tank, if for example the site constraints were such that you couldn't get this leaching field below the septic tank, so it would flow by gravity, then you could perch this up on a hill or some other remote site, put in a small pumping station and pump the effluent up to the site, and it will do the
which direction thing. Does the effluent flow from the chamber system back
down
hill into the house?
Pardon me?
Back toward the house itself in this case. Lot number 5 has a
yes.
Yeah.
There. It should not be a problem. It should disperse into the groundwater table and move around.
Or be collected around the drainage of the house itself?
There's a possibility that it could be.
Does that complete your presentation?
Yes, it does.
Okay. We're running a little bit behind on this one, but are there any other questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I did have a question about the filled area and the culvert underneath the filled area. Has that been addressed? I wasn't at the last meeting. Whether or not there are constraints there, whether or not the culvert system is adequate to handle?
I am not certain, but maybe we can get an answer for that.
Are you speaking about the culvert? There's the fill, and it's a large mass, and then there's a culvert to the, I guess, west of it, right? To the left of it on the plan. Is that correct?
I believe that's
yeah.
correct.
Well, I guess we didn't get out there on the sidewalk, but the culvert itself is exposed, right? And actually what it's doing right now is it's allowing water to flow through even faster than if we had tried to fix it. So I guess it would be a determination of whether it would be desirable to actually place more fill in the wetland and fix the culvert, which could actually slow down drainage through that area.
Was that an engineering calculation and decision? I just remember on the sidewalk where one of the neighbors indicated that partially because of the fill, there seemed to be an increase in water on his property. And I was wondering if anyone had looked at how that water flows, and particularly in the channel areas, the streams, and whether any engineering had occurred.
Yeah, we have looked at it and determined that actually what has happened is flood waters or high waters have actually washed over what was an old logging road, which is why the culvert was installed. And over time the waters have eroded any soil around that culvert. So now there's actually a wider opening than there used to be when the road was first installed. And then, of course, there's question whether it be if it would probably increase or at least slow down the movement of water across that area if we actually tried to fix it. So we have not proposed to fix it at this point.
I guess I have a question. Is water backing up at that culvert, or is it flowing freely through?
It's flowing freely over, even over the road that's there and whatever. That area does very little to stop. The old logging road in that culvert does very little to stop any flow when it comes to, you know, especially flooding times.
Yeah, the stormwater report that we receive does show flow in and around that area. And there are CFS calculations here that tell you what it is. Mr. Boxer?
The Greenbelt plan that you had looked like it stopped. And maybe I missed the explanation of where it goes on the other end. I understood that it connects to something on the rear of the property.
Right.
It's
what we're doing, I think, is just providing another piece to a puzzle. It was expressed by the commission that they're trying to establish a green belt and they're trying to hook up different open space areas. And they express the fact that this property could act as a one of the pieces of a linkage that would eventually connect the Canterbury and the Hobstone developments. Right now,
you're not
all we can
have access out to Mitchell Road.
No, you're not proposing access out to Mitchell Road.
Why can't you just kind of keep moving that thing down and follow the property line?
It would go through the wetland, and it's impassable.
Okay.
Unfortunately, it would have been a good suggestion.
The other question I have is on the buffer that we talked about last time. It was my understanding that you people will then talk to the neighbors and present some sort of a plan that
they at least had discussed with you. I'm not saying they have a veto right. What you described a while ago, I think, was 10 trees. I don't know whether those are in addition to what you had proposed the first time, and how many are on what side, and whether, in fact, they do buffer those homes adequately from the other homes. Have you had any discussions with the neighbors?
I'm Ken Tubbs of KW Associates. This afternoon I visited Mrs. Alexander and had the opportunity for the first time to see what our land looks like from her perspective. And we briefly talked where we would put white pine to, in essence, give her a suitable buffer on her side. After that, I went and visited Ed Drinan and explained to him that we were going to put white pine along here to buffer any view of this house that he would have, and also fill in some gaps over here at his brother Mike's house and basically do the same thing for him. So I did get a chance to see the neighbors today.
Is the total of what you discussed with Mrs. Alexander and the Drinans the 10 trees?
I believe we're looking at more than 10 trees now. Well, we did take a few from here and moved them over here, so it might be 10 total new ones, but we felt that we didn't need to keep 7 here, so I think we now have 5 here, 6 over here on Mrs. Alexander's border, 2 more here, making a total of new ones, 6, 11. 11 new trees in addition to what we originally proposed.
Did you receive concurrence with the people you spoke with?
I believe Mrs. Alexander was receptive to my idea on her side. Mr. Drinan, I believe, may request additional from our conversation.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, I know Mr. Tubbs is being put on the spot. I kind of counted, and they seemed to add 13. They took away 4 from the previous plan for a net increase of 9 trees.
I may have to refer back to my consultant on that. 9 additional.
Nine additional trees with some change.
Nine additional trees with some being moved from different locations as per request of the abutters.
And the increase in size along the abutters areas that are a concern.
I was under the impression from the last meeting that you weren't going to be taking anything, and this wasn't really a trade situation. We had this discussion, and I guess if you proposed them originally, you must have thought they were needed, I guess, for whatever it is, 4 or 5 trees. I'm having trouble understanding why we need to move away.
I think you said yourself that you felt it was more important to buffer with the abutters than to buffer along Mitchell Road.
I don't think I said that. I might have said that, but not in the context of removing something that apparently was decided as necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a problem leaving the ones that you originally thought were necessary on Mitchell Road and putting in the ones that are necessary on the side. That was what I thought you agreed to last time.
Well, I don't personally have a problem with it. I don't believe my partner would have a problem with that. For four more trees, I'd say no. I'd like to put in twice as many as we're going to put in, but I think it would be cost prohibitive to do it. But I have no objection to putting in, you know, four, six, eight. Ten.
You're about to start a forest. Ms. Blackshire, are we finished with that question? Okay. Have you completed your presentation?
Yes, we have.
Are there any additional questions from the board?
I have one relative one and one sort of unrelative, but you're the person to ask. The pathway extending between Canterbury and Hobstone as we eventually put together our pieces of the greenbelt, will that be eventually dedicated to the greenbelt so that the public can use it?
Yes, that is okay. Is going to be
there'd
dedicated.
Been some,
yes.
I'm not sure where in all this there was some talk about putting in a pedestrian walkway for the use only of the subdivision.
Oh,
and I'm
right.
Trying to make sure that this will eventually become dedicated to the public.
Yes, this will be.
Okay. Now, my second question is, just because I'm curious, what is a Cape Cod curb?
A Cape Cod curb is something that's, I guess, more or less standard throughout the Cape, and it's approximately 12 inches wide. It's made out of asphalt, bituminous paving, and it's kind of formed in a machine as the machine goes along. It's about 12 inches wide. I'd say about 6 inches on one side, and may go down as far as 2 inches on another. May only go up to 4 inches on one side. I'm Mark?
6 and 2.
Okay, so I was right. 6 and 2. It slopes. And some public works officials prefer them because if a snowplow rides up or somebody rides up, then they're not hitting a curb. They're kind of riding up on it.
Okay.
And it was requested in this case.
I didn't know if they match the Cape Cod houses. Well, I asked, now we know.
Any other questions?
In general. Yes, sir. Could we talk for a few moments about the sewerage issue and what the applicant is proposing as opposed to what the applicant is allowed and what the town planning board might want and what the council now allows or the town allows and what the town is now thinking about changing its policies. So I guess the first question I would have, as I remember, there were three lots allowable for entrance to the sewer. Two lots are being proposed to be sewered. Four lots are being proposed for septic disposal. And I know from the time that the original pre-application conference was held and then the sidewalk was undertaken and then during the public hearing, discussions have occurred on a continuous basis about whether or not this town should allow subdivisions to occur on septic systems where sewer lines are in evidence and apparently capacity exists. And I understand the issue of community ordinances that don't allow more than so many lots to be sewered, but I understand that issue is being revisited currently by the town council, its ordinance committee, and at least some sentiment in the town. I'm sorry, I was with Mark Gray.
Sediments or sediments?
Storm drain systems. Some sentiment in the community to change that policy, or at least to discuss changing the policy and then coming back to the issue at some point. As one member of the board, I'm very reluctant to approve a subdivision that has the capacity for public sewers there, adjacent to it, serviceable, and allowing septic tanks to be put on
into that subdivision as we review and would approve or deny the application. I guess I want to make the point that from an overall standpoint, I have some trouble with doing that, and I would hope that we would find some way to resolve that issue, at least in my mind. Second issue is the adjacent properties to the south and the sensitivity that has been expressed by the neighbors to the south. We have two septic tanks along that property line, and at the very least I would want to see as one member, again, lots 4, 5, and 6 being sewered if there are three sewer hookups allowable. I would want to see a condition from a personal standpoint again, and would propose that a condition that if the town does change its ordinance that allow more than three hookups, then the other three lots would be sewered properties rather than having individual septic tanks to occur. Now, presumably there will be some time between now, if we were to take action, and if it were affirmative action approving the subdivision, between now and when the project would be built. We have a final plan review process that we would be going through as well, and I would hope that the town council, its ordinance committee, would have revisited that issue in its ordinance and would have made a determination whether it wanted to change the ordinance or not, so that maybe by the time we had a final plan review, we would have at least had that town input on whether or not they were going to change it. So I guess there are a couple of issues. One is they've chosen the two lots to sewer that are right next to the road. That is an appropriate applicant process because that's the least expensive way to do it. I would, because of the sensitivity and the drainage of the site, I would really like to propose that lots 4, 5, and 6 be sewered, public sewers.
May I add something to that? We have looked into, because we understood the concerns of the abutter and the board, and we have looked into what it would take to do different options on the sewer. And what we've determined is if we had to bring a public sewer down the road, it would make the project unviable because of the grades. We couldn't do it.
Because of the
cost? It would
cost.
Require
okay.
A pump station.
Okay.
Plus the force
of,
main.
Because of the grade, you said?
The subdivision is
okay.
Lower than the road.
All right.
So it would just be quite a huge sum of money to do that. It would make the project unviable. We could not place that value on the lot. The lots would not take that sort of cost in their price. So, and the other thing that I'd like to point out is that there is an existing septic system on for the existing house. That system, the existing system is about, I'd say, 50 feet from where the new one is going. That will be removed. And the new one is going to be 50 feet away from that one. So almost like you might think of them as canceling each other out. So that means that, you know, there's no increase in right there. Lot 6 is sewer. This one now is basically just replacing the one that was there. And the one for lot 4 then is actually the way that surface flows are, they're going back away from the areas of concern by the neighbors. And that we've looked into these different issues and that's what we've come up with.
So it's your statement that basically there's only going to be three new septic systems, really.
Yes, and you know, don't think of three being right here. Basically, it's just that, yeah, we're going to, almost like we're just getting one on that lot.
Okay.
There are four new septic systems, one of which cancels out because
the other
right,
has
so
been eliminated,
three,
is what
yes,
you're saying.
Right,
Mr. Chairman, if I might ask the question, the applicant then has determined that the project is not viable if public sewer were required for three hookups going
six.
All the way to the end?
Doesn't matter.
Even for six?
We did look into it. We understood, you know, we...
But it is viable for two.
Because of this, what we proposed are, without bringing a sewer down down Meadowview Lane, we're hooking directly
into
from
it.
The lot into Mitchell Road, and therefore now having to construct pump station, only one small grinder pump station for lot 6, and that cost is about the same as the septic system, so that owner will have about the same cost.
Mr. Chairman,
sure.
If the town didn't have an ordinance that only allowed so many hookups. Any subdivision, I think, would be required to hook up to a public sewer system. And its viability has got to be something that's determined by an applicant at some point in the process. And I know that there's some difficulty in saying this because there is a community established policy by ordinance that only so many hookups will be allowed at the present time. But I know there's some sense and feel for the community that, particularly if a subdivision were allowable because of the soil conditions and sewer is available, then public sewer ought to be supplied and required of the subdivision. And that's a very difficult issue for me to propose because the ordinance hasn't changed. But the viability of the subdivision, if the ordinance were changed, is not a question the planning board can deal with.
May I make a suggestion, Mr. Tinsman? We're going to be soon probably addressing some motions that have been prepared for us. I wouldn't see where there'd be any problem to, if you'd like to draft a motion that presents a case here for a final plan approval being predicated on whatever the town has in place at that time, properly drafted motion, we could address that motion along with the other ones that we've got before us.
That's a good suggestion. I'll do that.
Okay. Any other questions? Have you completed the question on sewers?
Just a comment, Mr. Chairman. I found the presentation on the stormwater runoff and on the sewers very illuminating and seemed very clear and logical. But I was a little frustrated at receiving a letter from our own town engineer, which was very brief and seemed to me inadequate in explaining why he felt these modifications were appropriate, and I wonder if we might ask him to be a little bit more elaborative and descriptive in his critique.
Would you like that to be in the form of a letter from the chair to our
town
engineer?
I think that would be helpful, just to precipitate a response.
I will draft such a letter.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other points at issue here? We have some motions labeled number 2 in front of us. I'd like you to take a look at them. Sounds like they may be lacking in at least one area. They may be lacking in others, too. My suggestion is that maybe Mr. Tinsman would like to draft some language on the sewer issue. We also have an issue related to the wetland that has been disturbed and what we would like to possibly do to prevent that from being disturbed in the future. So if somebody is prepared to make the motion with the two additional ones, maybe we could get something on the table at this point, if the board is ready for that. Would you like to allow some time for us before Mr. Butler to take a look at what we've drafted? Yeah. Okay. Please bear with us for a minute while we get our words straight.
urine from all entries on Friday the 21st. One entry per person, please. You must be over 18.
Maybe if you draft this compassion, you want to speak and attempt to put it all together, maybe read it for our benefit, and then maybe we'll get somebody to make the motion. Mr. Tinsman, did you have some suggested wording? What I'd like to do is ask Mr. Butler, this is a little out of the ordinary, we normally would have a member make the motion, but I'm going to suggest, you know, we've got some changes here, that Mr. Butler read the motion, which contains now five addendums to it, five conditions, I should say. Six? Okay, sorry, six. And if it's acceptable, maybe one of the board members would make the motion.
Okay. See how it goes. The motion could read as follows. Be it ordered that the request of KW Associates for preliminary plan approval for Meadow View, a proposed six-lot subdivision located at 379 Mitchell Road, be granted according to Section 16-2-4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the proposed stormwater runoff changes referenced in the Mitchell and Associates letter of June 15, 1989 and depicted in the preliminary grading, drainage, utilities, and erosion control plan, sheet 3 of 7, revised 6-15-89, be included in the final plan submission. B, that additional changes to the proposed stormwater runoff system may be required by the town engineer and or the public works director. C, that final information regarding the location, ownership, and maintenance of land to be dedicated for recreational or open space purposes, along with the potential creation of a pedestrian accessway, shall be provided by the applicant and resolved by the board during the final plan review process. D, that no structures, buildings, or any other type of wetland alteration shall be permitted to occur on the previously disturbed wetland area, as shown on the subdivision plan. E, that all lots shall be served by public sewers if the town council determines by a change to the sewer ordinance that additional sewer hookups are available prior to final plan approval. And F, that four trees will be added to the final subdivision plan as indicated and located on the June Planning Board subdivision plan as submitted, period.
I realize it's a lot to digest, but if you all agree, it's been moved. Do I have a second? Do we have a second to the motion?
I'll second it to put it
okay,
in.
Okay, the motion has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on the motion and its six conditions? Hearing none, would all those who are in favor signify by raising their right hand? Opposed?
Let the record show that the motion passed 4-1. Thank you. We're late, but we're on to our next item on the agenda, which is, find my agenda, Spurwink Woods, 27 lot subdivision, Spurwink Avenue, pre-application conference. This is under new business. Please identify yourself.
My name is Edward Drinan. I live in Cape Elizabeth and have for the last 13 years. I've never appeared before the board as a developer. I have as in the past as a citizen. I would like to, before starting, give some perspective as my role as a citizen and landowner in this town. One who has been involved in development of land in this town. In 1984, I was the owner of 20 acres of land on Mitchell Road, which had development potential of 10 to 12 single-family house lots. A development for that land was proposed of six single-family house lots. The development which occurred by my direction resulted in one new single-family home with the majority of the acreage placed in tree growth. 2 years ago, in 87, and last year in 88, I was the owner of land which came before this board for a development, the name of which was Runaway Farm. It was 28 acres of land whose development potential was eight single-family house lots. I insisted by agreement with the developer that no more than four single-family house lots be constructed, and I personally donated the majority of the land, 19 acres, to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Also, last year, after seeing potential for development of 76 acres in Bride Cove, I proposed to that developer and had discussions with the various people in town, which could have resulted in my purchase of the land and its development into nine rather than 22 house lots, with a good percentage, 30 acres plus, being owned outright by the Land Trust or under easement to the Conservation Commission. Well, that's sort of a history of a person whom is considered, at least by me, as a responsible steward of land in this town. I now come regretfully before you to propose a subdivision proposal. Before I get into it, I would like to review the history of it a little bit further. It consists of approximately 24 acres of land located between Mitchell Road and Spurwink Avenue in the northern end of town. And as you may have seen from background material which I submitted, I tried to prior to coming before you, I've appeared before the town council for two substantially different proposals for the development of this piece of land. One was called the open space proposal, and I'd like to show you what I proposed to the town council last year. This proposal was contingent upon getting the land sewered. The council eventually voted 4-3 against the sewerage proposal. It consisted basically of developing the land according to the diagram you see on your right. 26 condominiums constructed by Crest Development, the developer of the Canterbury condominium complex adjacent to this property on Route 77. That proposal would have clustered those housing units in the center of the land, leaving the majority of the land free, natural, and open space in perpetuity. It would have had no adverse impact by any surrounding houses or neighborhoods. None of those new buildings would have been seen by any existing houses. I thought it was a fine use for the land, and I was very disappointed that, for whatever reason, it could not be approved. The alternative, which I presented last year, is the diagram on the left, which depicts 26 single-family house lots. That was hastily and, as you can see, crudely drawn, but it does represent essentially what is before you tonight. It, as you can see, will call for the permanent ownership of almost the entire parcel of land. Its waste disposal will be on site. Alternatively, I proposed another use for this land, and that included a slight increase in its density allowance to allow the construction of some affordable housing. And by affordable housing, I do not mean what is perhaps commonly conceived of as affordable housing. The proposal called for the construction of a number of houses in the low 40s. They would be selling at approximately $200,000 apiece. Density bonus provided called for maybe 4 to 5 of those houses being labeled as affordable. My proposal called for 10 of those $200,000 houses to be listed as affordable, and I would sell them to those people who met the criteria for $100,000, thereby personally subsidizing our community's affordable housing effort to the tune of almost $1 million. The town council, in my opinion, has been non-responsive. Its reply is included in my background material to you. So, I am now left with the option to sell the land to a responsible developer, having been taken away, a concept which would leave the land primarily open space. The secondary proposal to do some affordable housing has been removed as a possibility. And now before you, I will present a conventional 27-lot single-family subdivision. This subdivision proposal calls for the development of the 24 acres of land with an access point from Spurwink Avenue and secondary road access being provided by one of two alternative means. Its waste disposal will be in a common area located here, and there will be a substantial amount of land dedicated as common space or under conservation easement donated to the town. The secondary means of emergency access have two possibilities. One is through a town-owned lot on Macaulay Road, right here. That would involve a 15-foot gravel road over approximately 100 to 150 feet of a one-acre town-owned lot. Its access would be simple and direct. Alternatively, the secondary access will go over land owned by me. It will be a long, convoluted run, which will run across the backs of a dozen or so property owners, but it certainly is economically feasible and technically and, I believe, legally possible. It's not something I would rather do. I'd rather leave this land unencumbered with a road. This is just a sketch plan and a preliminary discussion. There are a number of issues, I'm sure, of which you would like to address regarding this plan, and there are a number of alternatives which I would like to discuss also. With me tonight is Rick Light from Land Use Consultants, who will be here during the course of these proceedings to address any technical issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dryden. At this point in our proceedings, since we're in a preliminary review, I think it's probably right to ask the board if there are any initial impressions on this development and any questions of the applicant. We do this basically to clear up questions in our own mind and maybe give you some feedback.
First question I have is, you had given us two development concepts. Now they're mysteriously removed from our purview. I'd like to see those brought back for just a moment because I've got some questions about what happened. Maybe not so mysteriously, they were just taken. In your alternative B cluster development, which is your first proposal to the town through the town council, you required sewers to sewerage capacity to serve that proposed development. How many units had you proposed there?
My appearances before the council and the town sewer board lasted 7 months. Originally, I requested 39 sewer connections. That was refused, and I had changed my request to 18.
Okay. Do our ordinances prevent clustering provisions where a common septic system is used? I mean, you're proposing 27 units now, and essentially you're running sewer lines, but you're disposing of it on site in a spot that presumably will be appropriate for that disposal.
I think that as far as I can read, our ordinance does not prevent cluster developments from using common on-site septic.
Okay, but you're proposing virtually the same thing. Maybe I'm confused. You had a cluster proposal that you preferred to do, and the town apparently was non-responsive, or portions of the town were non-responsive in what would be required for that, which would be sewer hookups.
Yes.
And yet, you could do virtually the same thing if you were proposing something similar to what you're proposing for single lots, which is on-site common area septic disposal in one location.
That's true, and I think it's a very good question. Why am I not proposing it if I thought it was so great last year?
That's the question right out of my mouth and better expressed than I could have done.
The answer is I am not a developer. And my background, as I just explained, and I have controlled the development of some projects in this town, and I was attempting to control the development of this land before you. My way of doing that was to sell the land to a competent developer. In this case, it was going to be the folks who built Canterbury. They were going to do what I thought would be a nice thing to do over there. It wouldn't tax our town systems, and it would leave most of that land as open space. Their condition to me was, get the thing sewered, and that's what we'll do. I wasn't able to get the land sewered, so that did not happen. They are not interested.
From a town planning board process, your use of a common septic system with on-site disposal, sewering the individual projects, is as close to sewerage as you apparently feel that you're going to get to do in this project. You're going to put sewer lines in, and they're all going to go to a septic disposal field rather than a public sewer line under your concept plan that you have before us.
I have no alternative, I feel, at this time.
I think you're probably right at this time. Although the previous application, we talked about the issue being revisited by the council. I don't know how far they're going to revisit it, and we can only await their ordinance. process. But I'm still a little bit confused why you can't propose that. I mean, you're being a developer here. You're going to sell, you're going to put in all of the improvements and all of the lines and the common leach field, and then you're going to sell off individual lots. You're being a developer here.
I make no bones about it. I'm here before you as a developer. I don't think that you have, nor will you see in the immediate future, anybody who will come before you proposing to develop condominiums in this town.
I think you're probably right, and that's the other part of it.
Is
and
that from a market standpoint?
Yes. Marketing standpoint. I am not proposing in this development proposal before you to build houses. I'm subdividing the land, and I intend to sell individual lots of land.
Okay, I have another question. Now, alternative A required, again, sewerage for that proposal.
Alternative A was... the single-family concept here, that's what I told the town the council would probably happen if it did not approve the sewer request. There weren't too many folks around last year willing to build condominiums in this state, and I thought it was a fine chance to grab a hold of one of them and leave the land in pretty good shape.
How is your alternative A, single-family, different from the proposal that we have here?
The one before you was more refined, number one. It meets all of our ordinance requirements, and that was this one here is a simple sketch plan. But it actually turns out to be fairly accurate compared to what happened a year later after some further study and engineering is done. I think it's accurate as far as its concept, its intention to depict goes.
I have a bunch of questions, Mr. Chairman. Do you mind if I get mine out of the way? Okay. The town-owned land off Macaulay Drive was given to the town for a specific purpose. Was that the tall pine stands?
Red pines, yes. So now, red pine, southern pine, yes.
I remember that was very important when this board went through a subdivision review previously and wanted to preserve that stand of tall pines. Now, what you're proposing is because of a long road system, we're going to put a gravel fire access lane through this tall stand of pine trees that we preserved in a previous approval.
My proposal is, again, one which I think the town should take advantage of. I think it's to the town advantage for, we can certainly say for reasons of safety, a short direct run. But I think from an aesthetic standpoint and a conservation standpoint, an ecologic standpoint, it's better to use a short run through that land, and it can be done without disturbing the existing beautiful trees that are there, rather than the longer run. My proposal tonight is to use the longer run. If the town sees fit, take the shorter one.
Well, we have an ordinance that allows a road length of 500 feet, I think waivable to a certain extent. We've had our own workshop meetings over the last couple of years about the use of that waiver, and what you're proposing is a road that is that 1,400 lineal feet or 1,900 lineal feet? Road A.
It's,
if I may,
it's 14.
1,400
feet. Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, to go from the Spurwink Ave all the way up to the end of the easterly spur would be actually in excess of 1,400, though. It might be 17,000 square feet.
Lineal feet.
1,700.
Sorry, 1,700.
From Spurwink to the end of what is called Road B, yeah. It's more like 1,700 lineal feet.
It's more than what's worth. They measured from
intersection.
From intersection, right, and then right above, so it'd be a little bit more.
And that is appropriate. We're looking from length of a road in that could be intruded on at any given point.
Right. So that's so the end point would be actually more than 1,400.
That lot is something that I think that we're going to have to look at. whether or not to allow any kind of gravel fire access across the road, across the lot that was previously saved in the subdivision, I think is an issue of importance. Whether that's an alternative, there are other alternatives, and that's to not allow a road waiver in excess of 500 lineal feet that's a dead-end road. So there is another option to a fire access road in two locations, and that is a road that's 500 feet long.
I understand that. I also understand that there's been, I don't think, a precedent established in this town that would limit a road longer than 500 feet as long as it does have secondary access.
And that's approved by the planning board?
Yes.
Correct.
Right.
And that's approvable by the public safety people. Public safety people on gravel fire accesses and temporary roads is an issue that, as you're aware, has been discussed a lot in the last couple of subdivisions. And it's an issue that's coming to the forefront and one that's pending right now, Broad Cove.
Yes.
Has the common area been tested to the satisfaction of the engineers, knowing that it can serve a 27-lot common leach field area?
Yes, it is. Testing was done, and we stopped at 30.
What criteria are you using? I know they used a single-family home, but how do you decide whether there's enough land available? You size the leach. Actually, this is just a giant septic system, right?
Yes. I'll answer that, and if you'd like more specific information, I think Rick could, but my observations with the field engineer that day were, although his observations, I think, were studied in meticulous, it seemed rather basic. The a backhoe and a backhoe operator would dig a trench here and here, and the engineer would make observations, then more trenches here and here and here and here. We went around an entire area. And he thought that the entire area, or an area certainly large enough, could be constructed to hold, in this case, up to 27 septic systems.
And how big is that square that they would be constructed on?
It's 24,000 plus square feet.
Does that have an area for replacing that septic system?
The systems which would be built would all be individual ones, 27 individual septic systems within that area.
Another interesting concept.
It would save a lot of potential problems down the road. If a system fails, it's one particular homeowner's system that has failed. Not
everybody would own their own?
Yes. That's right.
Tombstone
piece
or something
of the non-rock.
Have we done that before in the case?
I don't know.
We have had some precedents of, they use the term, pooled septic systems, but I don't think we've ever seen something like that.
I think it's the better way to go.
Very interesting to see that explored.
It's expensive, but it's it works better.
Elizabeth Farm was originally on a private septic system. I don't know if they're connected
big
up.
Big one.
Well, we pooled
a couple of big ones.
That was many years ago.
That's the one I was thinking of.
Yeah, that's the only one I can think of.
Mr. Dryden, could I ask, I'm a little fuzzy here about some of the proposed extended accesses and how it relates or matches up. One, I understand, would run off perhaps Road B and go through town land and the pines, is that?
Yes.
Yeah. And the second one would go through land all owned by you, and you have legal title to it?
Yes.
And to the land that you're going to hook up to?
That's right. I wouldn't propose it otherwise.
Some people have.
That's true. As wide as safety and other considerations to determine. I'm anticipating 15 feet. No, not yet. I thought there were a couple different things to be discussed here before I took a proposal to the public safety people. I'm assuming public safety, if it has an opinion, will say, let's take the short straight run. And I know that that opinion won't weigh too heavily in the final consideration as to whether the short straight run through town-owned precious tree lot land is used or the longer run.
You should be aware, I don't want to interrupt any other questions, but you should be aware that we have received a letter from our town engineer on this preliminary proposal. I don't know whether the applicant has received a copy of that. It may be a good idea. Our town engineer raises at least four issues for consideration in your future presentations to us, and we will make a copy of the letter available, so it will help you in your work. One is wastewater disposal, including soil suitability, and the institutional problems inherent in joint use or cluster systems. We just basically covered that a little bit just now. Building suitability of several lots with severe topography, and I guess we'll get into that a little bit with the site visit. Road and drainage design in pronounced topography area. I guess these must be the severe areas he's talking about. And stormwater management in general. So those are four areas that the town engineer has hit. So you might want to think about those in future presentations.
All anticipated and deserving considerations.
The purpose of this meeting is really to have an interchange between the developer and the planning board as to the proposal and the creativity of it, the imaginativeness of it, the safety features, and all of those things that we'll ultimately have to deal with down the road. And I guess I'd just like to address the aesthetics of this, and I can't say that I find it terribly appealing. It looks to me like just as many lots as you almost can possibly get on there have been put on there in a not very imaginative design. I also am very concerned about the length of the cul-de-sac, and our ordinance does say that we should not have any more than 20 dwelling units if we grant a waiver for 1,000 to go into the 1,000 feet, and that is in our ordinance now as a maximum. And I think we are currently discussing in other developments, and this is an issue that perhaps the planning board needs to discuss in workshop, the advisability of having a second access and fire access through a development of this size. And I think that in this particular case, this would be tremendously important to have a workshop on that particular feature. I would personally like to see more of a cluster system arranged, not for so much for the sewers, but for the septic, but for the arrangement of the houses. And I think your first or proposal A is much more appealing aesthetically than what we're seeing here. And I gather that perhaps even you feel that way. But I just want to express, from my personal point of view as one planning board member, my reaction to the present plan.
I'm actually, Mrs. Rand, surprised to hear your reaction to this, because last September, regarding the cluster proposal, here's what you had to say. I do feel very uncomfortable as a member of the planning board. Earlier, you had spoken as the chairman of the planning board, looking down the road to see what's going to take place in the future. We have a large development that will probably come before us on the corner of Woodland and Mitchell Road, and there are others that surely will come before us. And I would urge you strongly to deny it. And I think that your appearance before the council was effective. I think it carried, as you said, that your position at that time as chair of the planning board, I think it carried a lot of weight. And that's the proposal that I believe was shot down forever that night.
What I am suggesting is, I think it would be very nice to have a cluster system in both sewer and, or septic, and a unit like this.
I'm not suggesting that we put in a whole lot of different sewer hookups.
Well, we're not going to see any condominiums on this land.
Chairman, I do have some other questions. Any wetlands on the site?
Not that I am aware of. I think there's a possibility that wetlands exist in this area. I asked the surveyors to flag in a very liberal way anything that they could be considered as wetlands, and it came down to this area here.
Will you have some sort of wetland survey done?
I anticipate that I'll be asked to.
Are there any other questions at this time?
Mr. Chairman, do you want some initial reactions? We've asked some questions.
That might not be a bad idea.
I sense some emotion as you propose this subdivision and as you become an applicant before the town. Some emotion that many of us have not participated in, and you've cited some who have participated in some of the previous actions. Eliminating all the emotion, however, we have to view this as a raw piece of land. We will take the ordinances, you will propose what you plan to build, and we will then react to those plans however they may be expressed, whether they're cluster or single family homes using the whole property. I think you've heard of some of the concerns tonight. Those will be real concerns as we step through the process. At the risk of biasing one member, myself, and I hope that I don't do that, this will be a very unique subdivision. We talked about imagination and the imaginative use of land. We haven't seen this style subdivision at this size and this scale in a decade in this town. Conventional lots, large piece of land, and so most of them have been more creative trying to use the land, much like your option A or alternative B that you initially came in with. That's the level of planning that we've seen in this town in the last few years. Your plan does not include some of that imagination. I understand the emotion and some of the issues behind that. I hope that we do not deal with those emotional issues. I hope we deal with the ordinance requirements that are imposed on you. Some of those are length of roads and adequacy of a number of things, including wastewater disposal. I wonder about the adequacy of putting individual septic systems in a common area. I have to question that. That'll be a technical issue that the people will look at. From a lay standpoint, I see a lot of difficulties with it, but maybe those can be resolved when you come in with your application. I guess I'm concerned by this style of subdivision, and I hope that emotion isn't driving it, but I hope that the appropriate use of land is more driving your subdivision process.
I agree with everything you've said. There is undoubtedly some emotion involved here because I would rather not be here before you as a developer of this land. I would like you to accept as fact that I have tried earnestly for a long period of time for what I consider to be very viable alternative uses for this land before other members or other boards of this town. I think the specific issues that you mentioned are ones that can be technically satisfactorily answered. I have one of the things that I would like to walk away from this preliminary discussion with tonight is this. The issue of on-site septic, I think, will be with us for the duration of the project. If there is any possibility that during the course of this project, this board, based upon sewer data, which I have...